So thank you, Tommy Gaynor. We have Tommy Gaynor here today on the Lift Your Shot podcast. He's come with a wealth of experience in terms of both running his shops as well as selling his shops. I mean, kind of taking on a new position that he's going to go into and dig a little bit deeper. So Tommy, thank you so much for being on with us today.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. And so if you wouldn't mind kind of sharing with the listeners and the viewers kind of a little bit about yourself, your background, where you're located, how you kind of got started in this industry.
Yeah. Interesting start. So I'm 46 years old, just turned 46. I'm in Vancouver, Washington, just across the river from Portland, Oregon, in the Pacific Northwest. My father started our business in 1986. Single location, and grew up as a normal child in the business. I was around, I was always, cleaning and painting and just on the facilities. My dad really never wanted me to work on cars. So graduated high school, went to Boise State University and played football. My freshman year, hated college football. So I transferred to Washington State University and finished up there. And it took me 4.5 years to graduate. So came home about Christmas time, and I had been accepted at Oregon Health Science University in their physician's assistant program. And I was going to go into that. And that didn't start until August. So I had about 8 months to kill. So I was living with my parents, hanging out, and my dad had an assistant manager quit. They had two stores at the time. And he was talking to my mom, we were at dinner, and I could kind of see where this conversation was going, and I was avoiding that. I'm like, okay, not involved. And my mom pulled me aside afterwards and said, hey, your dad had an assistant manager quit. He could really use some help. Would you go help in the shop? And I'm like, no, I hate going to shops. And she asked me, I'm like, okay. So I told my dad, I'm like, here's the deal. I'll come and help you. You have me until the 4th of July. At 4th of July, I want a month to go water ski and wakeboard and hang out before I go to school. And started doing that, and I loved it. So never left. So fast forward from there, we grew it, started with two stores when I started, and ended up with five. 38 to 40 people, depending on the season. We, rotate a couple of guys. In the summer, I had a couple extra guys and in a little busier times, but 40 people, a little over 11 million in revenue.
Awesome, awesome. So yeah. where are all the shops located?
We're all in the city, like in the, not city limits, all Vancouver city addresses. Some are in what we call Clark County, but yeah, they're all pretty dense where they're at. Like the farthest distance between two stores is about 12 miles and the closest is about 3 miles.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, and then when, so the last, the fifth store, when was the last store created?
July of 19.
July of 19. Okay.
Yeah. And that was honestly the one before that was in 08. So it, and the July 19 was all, and we were ready like pre-COVID. We had put together a pretty good war chest to go buy some shops.
Oh.
We really wanted to grow and, which was, super fortunate timing for us that we had a bunch of money put aside. COVID wasn't terrible for us. It made us become better operators. It really made us dive deep into expenses. It really only slowed us down for about 6 or 8 weeks. But we really dove into expenses and cut out some fat and made us better operators. So that, like say July 19, pre-COVID there, that fifth location was interesting. It was our transmission builder that we used. It was a transmission shop that had been around for like 4 years. He called me up and said, hey, do you want to come buy some equipment? What do you mean? He said, well, I'm going to retire. I'm like, whoa, who's going to build our transmissions? Like, you can't retire, right? You can't have you going away. So I said, let me come over and take a peek. So I came over and I kind of looked around. I'd been in the shop for a while. It's a pretty nice shop. They had a few guys working for him. I was like, well, what about all these guys? He's like, oh, I don't know. I said, well, how about I just buy everything and I'll lease your building? So we put a deal together and I acquired that shop. So it's a great shop, and it's actually worked out really nice for us because we were, you know, that's who was building all of our transmissions. And obviously we've tried to grow the wholesale business a little bit also. So it's a good store now.
Awesome. That's super. Yeah. So that kind of leads us now, I guess we're getting pretty close to present time. So I know the story shifts a little bit. So why don't you share with the listeners kind of what kind of took place from then, and we'll go
sure.
from
there. So I'm not sure if you're familiar or not with the Bottom Line Impact Groups, John Loeffler. That's now owned by Cecil Bowler. It's a 20 group, a group of 20 groups. They were founded in the Seattle area.
Anyways,
I've been involved with it for a long time and became close to some of the other guys in the group. And one of my good friends, Chris, his family had 9 stores in the Phoenix area.
Okay.
And they sold 2 years ago to Greenbrier, which has now been acquired by Leonard Green Partners, which is Sun Auto Group.
Okay.
They had been acquired for him. He was working for them. And so last March, I was in Phoenix and went and met him, and we went out and had dinner. And he said he had just been promoted to their vice president of business development. And I said, that's cool. And he said, you know, I just want to let you know, he said, we've identified the Pacific Northwest as our next market. And so I wasn't really sure if he was being like threatening, like, I'm going to come up there and kick your ass, or if he was like, hey, there might, and that was not the case. He said, there is some opportunity. We're going to try to buy some shops up there. He's like, you should let me take a look at your shops. He had seen our financials because we've been a 20 group. We exchange financials. He's a pretty sharp guy. So I said, sure, let's take a peek. So we started going through the process. And again, I sat down with my business coach, Jim Murphy, and our attorney and CPA. And they all said, hey, this is a good exercise for you to go through. So I went through the exercise and got a valuation and just really wanted to see what this looked like. So if I did want to sell in the future, I would kind of know what it looked like. And I told, I was very transparent up front that it's probably isn't the time for me. And the deal just kept getting better, not only financially, but like tax structure and just the way some of the deal happened. So we got to the 11th hour and I sat down with our attorney and CPA. They said, it's time. This is a, I'm not gonna say it's a once in a lifetime deal, but this is a very good deal. So we sold to Sun Auto and Tire. They now have 360 stores in about 20 states. So we're part of that network. I initially became the Northwest market director at the real similar time they closed on us. They closed on an 8 store group and a 3 store group in Seattle, Washington, about 2.5 hours north of us. So I initially started after acquisition overseeing those groups, ours and the ones in Seattle, and with the intention of moving into the business development side, mergers and acquisitions. So I'm now the number 2 on the M&A team behind Chris, who is a friend of mine from a long time ago from 20 groups. That's super cool. Get to work with my friend and travel around the country and buy shops.
That's super cool. That's a super interesting story. And so
yeah.
I mean, everyone is in different phases currently within their shop. Some are just starting, some are just right. I think of things really growing, and others are in that same phase where they're like thinking about, is it the right time to sell? How do I go about doing this? And so if you were to give those people advice, what would it be in terms of knowing when to sell and then the process of what that kind of entails?
Yeah, absolutely. So knowing when to sell, I mean, it's obviously a very personal choice,
yep.
Right? It's tough right now. Talent, super hard to acquire, good technical talent, good sales talent. The technology in the store, you know, to fix the cars as well as point of sale systems and digital marketing, digital inspection, and in the last 5 years has made some huge moves, and it's not going to slow down. So I see a lot of the guys that I'm engaging at this point are, I look at them, I see my dad, 71 years old, you know, in the 70s or 80s, they were really good technicians and said, I can do this better. And went out and started their own company. I would definitely say it's important to identify what that exit strategy looks like. Again, even if it is a, if you are maybe in your 50s and you know it's not going to be for 10 years, but what's that roadway or that path look like? Is it a child? Is it a key employee? Or is it someone like me or another shop owner? But identifying what that pathway looks like is very important. And I see a lot of guys that they don't have that plan. Yep. And it's almost sad, I guess, on a certain level. They just don't have that plan. They, you know, some of these guys have gotten to that 70 plus year old and they don't know where to go. A lot of times it seems like with children and with the key employee situation, the owner becomes the bank. And they're going to carry the note, you know, they're going to hold the paper for 10 to 20 years. So, but again, I don't, especially with children and family and even that long-term key employee, if they're in the financial position to do it, it's rewarding to see that go on to children or go on to a key employee.
Absolutely. And
yeah,
I love how you say just making the plan. And so I guess what would be your recommendation in terms of where should they look to then start making a plan? Is it something that they're speaking with maybe their family member, like maybe their spouse or whomever that may be? Is it reaching out to a CPA and an attorney for that? Or what would be your suggestions?
All the above.
Okay.
Yes. I definitely think I always believe in, no matter what I'm doing, running the clock backwards. Right. So there's a great book, you know, start with the end in mind. Right. So what is the end? If you say, I want to be done at 40, 50, 60, 70, whatever that landmark is, run that clock backwards. Mm-hmm. So you have 5 years, 10 years, whatever that number is, and then start that process. I've heard of guys that have identified a child or a key employee and started that plan backwards, that started a whole life insurance policy in their name that helped fund a large down payment because they had a 10-year runway. Mm-hmm. So they could fund a large down payment to help that key employer child put a downstroke on the business. You know, kind of a cool idea.
Yeah.
You can do the same thing with an investment, you know, an investment plan. We've done that. We did that before. We did that with our controller. We had what I referred to as gold handcuffs, where we established a retirement date for her. We didn't want her to leave, right? So established a retirement date and ran it backwards. It was about 10 years out. So we started funding, like, aggressively a private retirement account that we owned as the company. She got to call the shots on the investments, and at 10 years, it was 100% hers, above and beyond her normal IRA. If she didn't, it was based on a percentage of our net profits. If she didn't make it, she quit or got fired, it was ours. And I looked at it as, like, that was a nice chunk of change to go out and recruit the right controller to help financially run our business.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, but I think that, you know, as far as you can get ahead of it, 100%, I very rarely see guys that are selling shops be happy with the results of using a broker. I'm not saying ever. I'm just saying the knowledge I've seen, the broker doesn't get paid unless they sell a shop.
Yep.
So their deal is to, you know, price it cheap and move it fast. Price it cheap, move it fast. So I don't want to say that the sellers maybe don't get the best representation, but there's definitely a financial motive to the broker to move the shop.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, so that's where I guess like, a group like Sun is a little different. We're going to come in, we're going to look at, you know, your financials. We're going to, look at bank statements and tax returns and make sure all those things make sense, together. And we're going to give you a price and you're going to get almost all your money at the day of close. You're not holding paper. There's some escrow money put aside for reps and warranties for 18 to 24 months, and then that all comes back to you. So it's a really straightforward, clean transaction. There's opportunity if it, you know, and like myself and probably 25% of the sellers, they're not done working. They may not want to own a business anymore or that kind of business, but they don't want the day-to-day or the, I guess, the after hours of what's all involved in owning and operating a business. So they stay on at work.
Okay. No, that's information. And I loved how, I mean, you went into a little bit of like one of the options is like that key employee that's been there.
Yeah.
And everyone has that dream of like every employee they find is like that key employee. And
sure. Right now,
I think that it really resonates with people because everyone is looking for people. Like they're like, I want to grow. And I think we're growing, but we don't have the help. And I can't find any help. So right. If right now, I know you have extensive experience in a bunch of different hiring processes when you're running your shop. So what is your process for finding the right people, vetting them out and keeping them on board?
Wow. Okay.
We'll break it up into like the beginning.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Okay. So let's just talk about like talent acquisition.
Yeah.
And that seems to be the hardest right now. Mm-hmm. So acquisition, I'll talk about some things that I've done that I feel have helped. In any ad I write or post, I give them, I put in there, please call or text. I really think that in today's society, it's a lot less personal and a lot less, I guess, committed to just text. Hey, this is Joe. Saw your ad. Do you guys offer healthcare? Which I said I did my ad, but yeah, sure. You know, I mean, things like that. But they're able to ask questions and kind of dip their toe in without trying to schedule a formal interview. Mm-hmm. So I almost always, I always do give them the ability to text. But I can tell you, like with us, you can go through my phone. I bet I have 12 or 15 different prospective tech, prospective advisor, prospective manager, and their name in there. And they might be working in a shop and we may not have a spot for them right now. They may have saw an ad, text, I save their info, but I try to every few months just kind of give that touch. Just, hey, how are you? How's things going? Are you still at the Ford dealership? You still at this shop? How's it going? Just so when it's time, I got some guys on the bench. Like, you need, again, so let's go back to planning, right? We talked about transitional planning. You have to have a recruiting plan. You have to always be recruiting. I don't care if you're one shop or if you're 15 shops, you always have to be recruiting. That doesn't mean you're always hiring. There's a difference between recruiting and hiring. So making sure your name's out there, making sure you're writing ads that talk about what you can do for the new team member, not what they have to, must have own tools, must have clean driver's license, must. I mean, it's 2022. This is a employee's market. So you have to sell them on what you can do for their life. How are you going to benefit them? And then at the end of the day, you got to have good pay and good benefits. I don't want to say it's easy, but if it's done right with a system consistently, it works. It's what I see a lot is, oh God, we had a guy quit and we got to fire this guy. Now we need two guys tomorrow. And people make these desperation hires and just put a body there. So I guess I will stop myself real quick and say this also. I've seen the flip side where some guys try to go through two or three interviews and go to dinner, and I want them to meet the whole team. And I guess that's great in the right world, but so competitive right now, I really feel that you need to be able to have an initial phone call, which I make that my first interview, which is an initial phone call. I try to get the guy from text to phone. Mm-hmm. Have an initial phone call that's usually 15 to 30 minutes, and then schedule an interview. And you should be able to, you should be ready to offer him a job in the interview. I say he could be a she, but them a job in their in the interview. Because if you don't and they get in front of me, I will.
Yeah, that's awesome. Being it goes back to where you're saying just be planned and prepared. So then, in terms of like keeping that bench, is that bench form just from the initial opening? Like there was a job opening and people applied, and now a few of the others didn't.
Yeah, absolutely could be. I think that's where we get the most, you know, when we have job postings, but always, you know, we have a careers page on our website that talks about the different positions, what they do, their responsibilities, who they interact with, how that works. And then a page about who we are and what we do. And again, like I said, what we can do for a new team member, as well as we really work hard on, we have some really nice stores. Mm-hmm. So, we've worked with our vendors to host technician trainings. So we get other techs in our stores. They're like, yep. Wow, this is really nice. It's clean and nice lighting and good equipment. Shoot. So I make sure that our manager or our general manager, myself, was there to, you know, put business cards in their hands and say, hey, you want to come to a place like this? It's a pretty good place. So, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No, that's all right. So, slightly interrupted, but we're going to start off again in terms of now creating a culture at the shop that people want to be at. So that way you don't have to work as hard for that recruiting process. How do you do that?
Yeah. So, that is the secret sauce. I always feel is the culture. That's when, and you can, I shouldn't say you, I feel like I can tell, like I've been in shops literally my whole life. Mm-hmm. I grew up in them, and now my adult career, I've worked in shops my whole life. I've been involved in 20 groups, so I've gone to visit other shops. And I'm literally at a point in my life or career, I can walk into a store and in about 5 minutes, I can give you a really good idea what the culture's like. I really can. So is there pride and ownership? Is there camaraderie and teamwork? What's that look like? To create that culture, I mean, it's like most things, starts top down. That's for sure a top down. And I believe it absolutely, positively, without a doubt, starts with appreciation. One of my old coaches that I worked with for a long time would say, you have to raise the attitude with gratitude. So making sure people know and understand they're appreciated. And you can't put a price on it. It is huge. Because as an owner or manager, you're going to come to a lot of those people with an ask. Hey, can I talk to you and stay like a half hour late? Miss Jones got to come down, pick her car up. Could you do that? Yeah, no problem. When they're appreciated.
Yeah.
Right. All those things. And it's those things that make the difference to the customer. Right. And so when the customer's happy, they tell more people. Mm-hmm. When the staff's happy, really good technicians travel in the same circles. I mean, I'm absolutely convinced of that. Same with service providers. They're friends with other service providers. They've worked at other shops. They have most of them, when they get to an established point in their career, have a pretty good network. And it's one of the best things I've always done is when we have that need for that team member, I'll go, if it's techs or advisors, whatever it is, I'll go to them and they know the spiel. Hey guys, we need a tech at, you know, this store. And I always tell them, I would way rather pay you than pay Indeed or someone like that. So you bring me a tech, they make it 90 days. I put $500 in your pocket. I would way rather pay them, pay my guy than pay Indeed. And there's a really good chance they know the guy's not an asshole. Right. I mean, they've worked with him. If they're going to vouch for him, they know he's probably not a hack. He's probably a decent guy to work with. So they've helped my interview process tremendously.
Yeah, that's awesome. Just kind of internal camaraderie and just using them to.
Yeah. So I used to, I think I told you earlier, I came from a pretty competitive sports background. As you can see the picture behind me, I drive a race car.
Awesome.
I've always been a pretty competitive person, and really young in my career, that wasn't a good thing. I was the guy that went around that would tell you all the things that are wrong. Do this better. We need this average RO. GP's low. Shop's a mess. Why'd you leave that bolt loose? I was that guy, like taskmaster, right? I was probably not a very fun guy to work with or for. I've matured and realized that that doesn't work. You know, there's some old, it doesn't work well long term. It doesn't make people excited. I had a really, really good mentor of mine that he gave me a challenge. He watched me. He came to work. This guy owned 20 some dealerships. He's still one of my biggest mentors today. And he came to work and just observed me for a day. We went out, had a beer that night, sat down. And I was like, oh, what do you think, man? We're good. Like, I was getting some stuff done. He's like, you're an asshole. You are. You're not very nice to people. I was crushed. This guy, I looked up at this guy. He said, here's what you're going to do. He said, I want you to take 5 nickels and I want you to put them in your left pocket tomorrow morning before you go to work. And every time you walk by and you tell someone you appreciate what they're doing, they did a great job, you give them a real uplifting, positive compliment, you move one of those nickels to your right pocket. And before you go home for the night, you need to have all the nickels in your right pocket. Do that until you don't have to use the nickels. Changed my life. It changed my life.
Yeah.
Because now I was looking for ways to celebrate people. I was looking for ways to lift people up. And now, jokingly, my old general manager, who's our current district manager here for Sun, he calls me the 240-pound cheerleader. Because literally that became like my whole goal is, how can I celebrate people? So now we have, you know, we have a whole awards, group of awards we give out every year for $1 million in sales by service advisors. You know, so like we have multiple service providers that sell over $1 million a year.
Wow.
We have individual guys. We have technicians that flag. We had, I think, 8 technicians that flagged over 3,000 hours of production this year. We give an award, give a couple of them away a year called the ACE Award for attitude, commitment, and effort. It may not be the best or most skilled tech. It may not be the best service advisor, but this is a guy that's got the best attitude. He's super committed and he's trying. Right. And so he gets his ACE award. So it's really fun. We give away a really big prize for 20 years of service. We do a drawing, our Christmas party for one of the drawings we do is for, we'll pay your mortgage for a month.
Wow.
You know, so we make it to where people want to be here. Mm-hmm. Like this is their friends.
Yeah.
So then, which is even better about, you know, that's when you get that retention period. Or point is when you get that really frustrating situation or they get that other shop that comes like, hey, I'll give you $5 more an hour to try and recruit my guy.
Yeah.
No way. He's not leaving. Why would he leave? He's leaving all his friends, leaving all this fun. Yeah. No way.
Yeah.
We do it at all of our stores. We call an image contest. It's coming up here actually next month. And so we tour all the stores with the district manager and identify some things like, hey, we need to like paint this area. You know, you guys are letting some old equipment pile up over here. The hoist need to be wiped down, whatever it is, right? Mm-hmm. Identify a list. You got 1 month. And then the winner at the month gets a new grill. So every one of our stores has a grill, but they get a new grill for the spring and summer season. And these guys barbecue like 2 or 3 days a week together for lunch. So yeah, just stuff like that we have going all the time. Keeps it fun.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. And I can easily see why people wouldn't want to leave. mean, right. And they would want to bring their friends with them. They tell them all about what's
100%. They hear all these things. And it's, I've heard the story several times from different tool truck drivers that, man, you won't believe this. I got a guy over at this other independent shop. He's wearing one of your hats. Right. I mean, just stuff like that. But, yeah. So no, yeah, awesome. It's good.
That's awesome. Well, thank you. And I love the nickel thing. I think that's something that I would love to be able to consistently share with more people as well. Where
it fixed me.
Like, it's just, and I think, well, I mean, currently, sort of our business is very virtual, and so it's a lot harder to have that consistent touch point compared to a shop. But I mean, there's always ways to improve and consistently appreciate your team members, even virtually. Yeah. But especially for shop owners, I think that could be so powerful, where it could make a night and day difference within the camaraderie and the feeling within the shop by just doing as small as that. So I love that. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. Then in terms of now, I know right now you're doing a lot more M&A. And so with M&A and the merger and acquisition side of things, you want to find that low hanging fruit of a shop that can be attained and then fixed quickly in order to then see the profit gain. Because that's the whole purpose.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to say no.
Oh, okay.
We want to buy good shops. Oh, okay. Because typically that stuff that can be fixed.
Yeah.
They're a pretty volatile situation because usually they don't have good leadership. Hmm. So if they didn't have good leadership, their people didn't feel appreciated or taken care of. And then when that guy sells, or the team's like, why am I staying?
Yeah.
Then what, I buy a bunch of used shop equipment? You know?
Yeah, for sure.
So no, we really look for and will pay for that good shop. Like, I want the good culture. I want to hear the list of the 10 and 20 year employees. Mm. You know, I want to know you guys have a big Christmas party every year. Like, when I start hearing that stuff, I'm like, yes, these are my people. Like, that's the stuff. Yeah. I don't want to buy fixer uppers. No, because really at the end of the day, what I'm buying is I'm buying someone's team that they put together, their policies and procedures, their equipment, and their ability to generate a certain amount of profit that's predictable. And a sign of a really, really well-run organization is that leader can step away and nothing changes because they have good policies and procedures that are in stone that everybody knows this is what we do.
Yeah.
So when that owner steps away, nothing changes.
Okay. Yeah. No, I like that. So, but then I guess in terms of then, I'm sure you've seen a lot of shops. And so,
oh yeah.
what are some of those key problems that you've seen that you think can be pretty quickly fixed?
So, the biggest number one consistent thing I see is shops that undervalue their services. They've gotten away from really the basics of the key performance indicators, you know, obtaining a certain amount of gross profit on parts and labor, being able to boil that down to a targeted net profit. We always, for a long, long time, the three numbers we always told our guys were, if you can get 60% gross profit overall, you can keep your expenses under 40%, you're going to have a 20%+ net. I mean, it's really, I know I'm oversimplifying things, but so a lot of shops have got away from that. Or there's not a good, especially when we get some of these multiple locations where there's not good leadership and they haven't really instilled those policies and procedures. You get this guy's pricing's like this over here, this guy's pricing's like this over here. They're completely different. He's buying because his buddy's the counter guy at O'Reilly's, so he wants to buy from him. Well, this guy likes this guy at, you know, AutoZone, and this guy, it's a hodgepodge. So that's probably the biggest thing. Losing focus on numbers. That's probably the biggest. Number two is groups that have not reinvested in their facility, or have just almost kind of lost like some pride of ownership. So I'm I always tell our team members, like, you should be proud to have your wife or your mom come walk through the shop. Mm-hmm. Always.
Yeah.
Right? If you're not, it's an issue. Like, that's something you need to address. So, and I say the same thing with our repair orders. Like, you should be able to hand your mom a repair order from a customer's car, and she should be like, yeah, well, it says here he brought it in because there was a noise in the left front area of the car, and the technician drove it, and there was a loose ball joint. So you removed the ball joint, you put a new one in, you did alignment, and now it's fixed. Like, your mom should be able to read, like, it shouldn't be diag noise, R&R ball joint alignment, $800. You know, it's back to that pride of ownership again, right? Yeah. Like, do it the right way. But those are the two big things I see is lack of focus on the KPIs, the key performance indicators, mm-hmm. and just a lack of pride of ownership.
So what are some areas that someone should reinvest back into the business that you'd see as like a low hanging fruit where like that it's common neglect, but is a huge positive outlook both for your team and customers?
So cleanliness takes usually just effort.
Yep.
And so I have a theory I use called, any manager I work with, I work on them in this whole Northwest and even some of the other states I've been in. I call it four corners and four walls. So on every lot, there's four corners of the property. So once a day, you should walk the four corners of your property looking in on your shop. Like, what would a customer see from the outside? And you got to look at it from that perspective. And I'm not saying that, and some managers get overwhelmed. And I'm like, oh, this isn't saying that you have to, you know, do all the landscaping and paint the walls. No. But you need to make that list so that's getting done. Or if you're a single shop owner, you're the owner. Like, you need to walk once a day, the four corners of your property, looking in on, pick up the trash, do those things from what they would see and make the list and prioritize it of, wow, that tree is rubbing on cars as people drive by the spot. We got to cut that away or trim that back, whatever that situation is. So that's four corners. And then I have four walls. So inside your building is four walls. Walk every one of those walls and look under benches, look on top of the overhead benches, look at the hoist and all the dirt and muck around there. So, and make that priority list. So cleanliness is typically the easiest and least expensive.
Yeah.
Next is paint. Again, you don't have to hire a professional. You can paint. You know, it's not sexy. It's not fun. But I remember we were first starting our shops. We would close down once a year. And we'd close down on a Friday night. And we'd move at about 3 or 4 o'clock. We'd move everything to one side of the building. We come in Saturday morning, we paint that side of the building, and we push everything to the other side of the building. And then Sunday morning, we paint that side of the building. On Sunday night, we come back and set it and hit the ground running. We just did it once a year, paint the shop. So it's just the cost of paint, right? You can do it yourself. It requires some effort. And I think Pops usually bought a bunch of pizza and beer. And again, if you have the right culture, it's fun.
Yeah.
Radio's on, you're hanging out with your buddies, you're making your workplace look better, you're getting rid of a bunch of old shit that's been sitting around on top of workbenches for a long time, and it's a nicer space to work in come Monday morning. Mm-hmm. So that's probably the biggest low-hanging fruit on the image side. I'm a huge hate, I use that word very rarely, but I hate banners, because most banners are someone else's banner. And they look good for about a week, and they start getting torn and dirty. And no, in the right spot, a unified look with your brand colors and your logo, banners can work, but they have a really short life cycle.
Yeah.
And most people try to triple the life cycle, so end up looking like hell.
Okay, no, that's perfect. I think it's really helpful for a lot of people to hear. Well, awesome. You've shared a lot of valuable information, I believe, for a lot of people, including myself. Cool. I'm very appreciative for your take on different elements of the shop and hiring and culture and just investing back into simple things. But if you had to leave everyone here with just one last tidbit of advice, what would that be?
Kelsey, you probably still want to start again. You froze up right there for a while.
Oh, dang it. All right. Tommy, you've shared a lot of valuable information with us today. And so I'm very appreciative of the time that you've taken. But if you had one last tidbit of information you'd leave for shop owners, what would that be?
You're not alone. Right. And I know especially a lot of single store operators feel like sometimes they're out on an island and they're alone. That's the majority. I mean, it's some crazy stat, like 94% of independent shops are single stores. It's crazy. There's only like 6% are multiple stores owners. So majority of them are single store owners. And I guess to feel like you're not alone, there's some really good free resources in like ASA. Really good group. It's free. That if you go into it with that, I'm here to learn, here to share, not tell people they're wrong attitude, you can get a lot from it. And if you're ready, I'm a big proponent in hiring a business coach. I worked with one, either Jim Murphy with Elite, I think was top of the heap. John Waffler, the Bottom Line Impact Group, is right there with them. And we've worked with both those guys for 20 plus years, and they've taught me a lot and held me accountable and made me better. So I think getting that, realize you're not alone. And like I say, even on the free side, some ASA groups or, I know NAPA, NAPA Auto Parts has some good groups, O'Reilly's, all those major parts have some good business development groups. Get involved in that and furthering your education as an owner.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. If anyone is interested in reaching back out to you, what would be the best way to possibly reach you?
You know, I'm pretty easy. So I'm going to give you my cell phone number. Honestly, for a text message is honestly just the best. And I'll almost always respond. It's 360-798-8998. That's 360-798-8998. Or my email is Tommy, Tommy, dot Gaynor, Gaynor, at sun, S-U-N, dot auto.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Tommy. Sure people will find this very valuable in terms of information, and I'm sure people probably will reach out asking some more questions.
Anytime. Love to help.
Experience. So again, thank you for your time, and looking forward to speaking with you again soon.
Yeah. Take care, Kelsey.